What can you do when you want to have more storage space than your internal hard drive bays and your storage server or NAS allow for? Today I'm going to use an opportunity I recently had to work with someone to set up a cluster and JBOD configurations to find what's the pros and cons of different clustering software compared to a JBOD solution, what was the performance of these different solutions, how they can be expanded, and hopefully this information will help you decide if a configuration like this might be right for you and what the pros and cons of this solution is going into it. Let's first take a look at what this user's requirements were for their storage solution, as well as the hardware they had on hand and wanted to reuse. This user wanted a large storage space for their Homelab storage environment, primarily storing media. They wanted to have reasonably high speeds, think in the hundreds of megabytes per second, with primarily sequential I/O. Random I/O was not going to be a large requirement here. They also wanted it to be easily expandable, being able to expand from the initial 3-node cluster to a 4-node or beyond cluster later on in the future if space was needed, as well as adding more drives to these servers if they wanted to add more storage by being able to relatively arbitrarily just slap another drive into a bay, configure it in the cluster, and get more usable space. Software-wise, they were pretty flexible about what could be used in terms of clustering software and that, as long as the Windows client was able to mount it. I have found being able to use a VM to mount whatever the cluster software is and then share it as a Samba share for almost any clustering software be mounted on Windows, even if it doesn't have a native Windows client, with generally pretty good reliability and performance from my experience. Hardware-wise, this user had three Dell R720XD servers. These servers had dual E5-2697 processors, which are Ivy Bridge 12-core processors, along with 384 gigabytes of RAM per node, a couple of SSDs for redundant boot drives in each node, and a SAS HBA so all of the 24 front 2.5-inch hard drive bays could be accessed directly by the OS. All of these nodes were attached via 10 gigabit network links, with spaces for additional nodes like these to be added later on. Hard drive-wise, this user already had 24 5TB Seagate ST5000 LM00 drives before we started planning this out. These drives, in my opinion, are kind of the dud of the hard drive market because they are SMR and lead to very poor performance in some use cases. But unfortunately, this user didn't really know that going into it, largely because Seagate and other manufacturers don't advertise that these drives are SMR very well at all. Also, being with 2.5-inch servers, there's not many good options for inexpensive bulk storage drives that these servers can use. Most all cheap bulk storage drives are 3.5-inch drives, not smaller 2.5-inch drives, which leaves your options if you want to use 2.5-inch storage to SSDs, which have a relatively high price per gigabyte, maybe down to about $50 or $60 per terabyte for modern cheap SSDs, or you go with these Seagate 5TB drives, which use the same slot at about $20 per terabyte. And it's really hard to justify using SSDs for quite a bit more cost when those hard drives seem fine at first glance. So I'm going to try to use these hard drives that the user already had on hand, but we're going to see pretty quickly that it does lead to some issues. I put 8 drives in each of these servers for the initial clustering setup, and I started installing an operating system. For my OS of choice, I chose Proxmox here. I'm fairly familiar with it, it supports Ceph and GlusterFS pretty well, and it's Debian under the hood so I can run almost any other cluster or distributed file system on this system. I first started off by using Ceph on these systems. I had 8 different drives, put each in their own OSD. Proxmox makes this super easy to work with and just added a simple volume and started copying my VM over to it. And copying my Windows 11 little Crystal Disk Mark test VM took over 3 hours. Looks like we're going to have some unacceptable performance at first glance. And looking at the Crystal Disk Mark numbers, they were in the maybe 20 megabytes per second maximum. That's what I'd consider to be unacceptable performance for this Ceph cluster. Now it's trying to figure out why the performance was so bad, because these hard drives can do 100 megabytes per second each, so that should be fine, right? And it turns out, in addition to these drives being SMR, they have awful sync performance. These drives perform okay without sync performance, about 100 megabytes per second read and write, but when I turn on sync performance, the performance just tanks, and they get about 1 IOP with awful latency. And taking a look at the OSD latency within the Ceph page in Proxmox shows the same thing. Hundreds of milliseconds latency and somewhere in the multiple seconds. And because it was across almost all the drives, it seemed unlikely that I had a dud hard drive or dud server here, and was likely just the way these drives worked. Which means that Ceph was probably off the table. I still tried doing a little bit more by using an SSD as a database drive to see if that would be the solution here, but it didn't improve the performance significantly. I also looked into trying to turn off sync performance in Ceph, but there didn't seem to be a supported way to do it, and I'd really hate to try to get some hacky way to turn it off because that could potentially lead to data loss, and I just want to stay away from unsupported configurations. So now it's time to look at other distributed file systems that hopefully don't use sync performance and would likely perform much better. The next thing I took a look at was GlusterFS. This is also easy to mount in Proxmox if you want to use it, and fairly simple to set up. But this user wanted to have a large amount of usable space, around 66% usable space compared to parity, which would require using erasure coding, which is kind of like RAID 5, but it's across the different nodes in a cluster instead of across the different disks in a RAID. And setting up the erasure coding in GlusterFS worked actually pretty well, and performance was decent in the hundreds of megabytes per second range. But the problem came to how we wanted to do expansion. From everything I can see about GlusterFS, it's typically recommended to have internal RAID running on your server using something like ZFS or MDADM RAID, and then have a single brick or relatively low amount of bricks on the server that are then going to be replicated or using erasure coding between the different nodes in the cluster. And what this means is it makes it kind of a pain to just add an additional node to a cluster, especially when you're using erasure coding, or being able to just add a drive arbitrarily. I'd have to add a matched amount of drives to all the different nodes in the network. And also, if I was running RAID 5 on the servers so that a drive could fail on the servers without taking everything down on that server and having to replicate all the data, that means I'm losing a little bit of data due to RAID 5 on each server, as well as the erasure coding between the multiple servers. This didn't seem optimal here, but GlusterFS is definitely a very capable solution. So let's take a look at another solution. MooseFS. I've used it a little bit in the past and actually did a video on it, and I like how you can have arbitrary drives in multiple servers, and it just manages chunks between all of those. The problem I found was, if I wanted to use erasure coding, which this user wanted to have that large amount of usable space, I'd have to buy MooseFS Pro, which was not going to be an option here. Another option I found to get erasure coding was to use LizardFS, which is a fork of MooseFS with some of the Pro features in it. The problem was, their website doesn't seem to show any of their own repos, and Debian, which had LizardFS in it previously, removed it in the current Bookworm stable release. And that makes me think, I don't want to stick with some old software that isn't really being supported, so that was being scratched off. I did run a basic MooseFS setup with just mirroring the storage, and it performed pretty well in the hundreds of milliseconds as well, easily adding a drive on multiple servers or adding an additional server. And I like for drives with mixed setups or adding nodes where it's quite good at just balancing data between the different boxes and moving it around as needed. But because of the lack of erasure coding, that was striked off as an option. I took a look at a few other distributed file system options like MinIO and a few others, but they didn't seem to check all of my boxes, so I didn't do any testing. Let me know if I actually missed anything you think would work here for these requirements, because I'd love to hear what these other options out there are. But looking at the different options I saw, Ceph had the easy expansion of drives and good erasure coding support, but had an unacceptable performance in all the use cases I could see. GlusterFS had good performance and erasure coding like I wanted, but adding drives just didn't work how the user wanted, and I couldn't find a simple way to do it. MooseFS had good performance and easy adding drives, but didn't support erasure coding, so more data would have to kind of be thrown away towards replication than the user wanted. Upon finishing all this testing, I reached back to the user with my results that none of these distributed file systems really checked all of the boxes they have. So then we'd either have to make compromises in terms of one of their requirements or look at other solutions. And this user was interested in looking at other solutions and see how they'd work for them. And it turns out one of the other solutions we talked about and seemed like it would work pretty well was adding a JBOD later on. And what the plan was is we could take one of these R720 XDs, fill it with the 5 TB hard drives, set up something like TrueNAS on it, and then add a JBOD later on for getting more storage space. The thought was with TrueNAS and ZFS, we could add VDEVs to the pool later on for a large single pool space that all the systems could access, as well as since we'd be splitting into multiple VDEVs, we can pull out one of the trays in the JBOD, for example, replace the smaller drives one by one with larger drives, and being able to hot expand the pool to have more storage space. The user seemed on board with this idea, and we looked for possible JBOD solutions, but In the meantime, we also wanted to test how well these 5TB hard drives would do in TrueNAS. And while these drives are SMR and not suited for ZFS applications, we wanted to see how badly these 120TB worth of drives would be, because we don't want to toss them out if we don't have to. So we tossed them all in one server, set up TrueNAS with it, and it looked like setting up a large RAID Z3 would make sense here. It'd be easy to have three drives fail and still being able to replace them, and while the rebuild times are pretty poor in Z3, we thought it would be okay. So we started doing our initial testing and copying files around, and it turns out we could have a sustained copy speed of roughly 500 megabytes per second. Not full 10 gig and not perfect scaling, but seems to be disk limited on the server, and still more than adequate performance for what we were looking for. The big worry with using SMR drives in ZFS is rebuild speeds, and we definitely saw that here. And it turns out it took quite a while to rebuild here. These drives averaged rebuilding at about 10 megabytes per second. So doing that for 5TB is going to be a long time. Over a week, it turns out. Not optimal at all, but seeing that we had multiple drives that could fail seemed acceptable for this use case, and hopefully we wouldn't have to deal with it too much. I also thought potentially doing D-RAID configurations, as it's optimized for faster rebuild speeds, which was one of the major issues of SMR drives. D-RAID also does sequential re-slivering, which sequential write performance should be much better on SMR drives than random write performance, which is typically the worst. Unfortunately, we didn't have time to test this, but it might be something worth looking into for your own ZFS SMR setup if you're forced to do something like that. And it looks like this user is going to be pretty happy with their large 24 5TB hard drive setup in this server, as well as with the potential of adding JBODs later on for additional storage. These hard drives are going to be slow to rebuild and far from the fastest if you're looking or scrubbing through media or something, but seem to have adequate performance for this use case, and this user is happy to be able to reuse the existing hardware they had without having to try to resell it or get rid of it somehow. Hopefully, learning about this experience taught you something about storage and different compromises. I think it's interesting to look at environments where you have hard requirements of what the user wants, as well as existing hardware they want to use, and try to find a solution that works well for the user. Let me know in the comments below if you've done similar storage setups and how they've worked for you, or if you've worked with setting these things up and how that experience was. Thanks for watching.